On his first full day in office, Malloy made it clear that he no longer wants to be called Dan.
A lot of promises are made.
He says now we are in a time of crisis, but we are also in a time of opportunity.
Clean out the state's finances and create jobs. That's the pledge tonight.
I want to take you on a road less traveled, but one that I believe will make all the difference.
Raising the gas tax, the sales tax, the cigarette tax, the alcohol tax.
Make no mistake about it, this budget belongs to Governor Malloy and the Democrats.
The one overarching concept that we kept in mind is one I called shared sacrifice.
It was conceived, passed, and signed all by Democrats.
We vote on a package that is responsible packages.
Your budget includes numerous new tax increases. How does that create an environment for luring new businesses in?
We have, in fact, turned a corner. And given the fact that we've turned a corner here in the state of Connecticut, we have set this state right, and we're moving in the right direction.
We will borrow not one penny for operating expenses. We need to change the relationship between the companies that are employing so many of our fellow citizens and their state government.
Now they say business is threatened by expanded taxes proposed by Governor Daniel Malloy.
It was this governor who said, no more tricks, no more gimmicks. I'm going to have the most transparent government in history. It was this governor who said, I will not borrow money to pay for operating expenses. Those are his words, not ours.
One-party government doesn't work. One-party government has given us the largest tax increase in the history of the state of Connecticut.
We have a deficit that is growing. We have deficits that will grow into the out years.
The budget that's out of balance, and a budget that is not honest and transparent, like the taxpayers deserve.
We have borrowed money unabashedly to pay operating expenses.
The taxpayer is completely maxed out.
Small businesses are closing every single day.
At some point, we have to stop, because the people we're representing, they're not buying this. They're saying, for God's sakes, if you say you're going to do something, do it.
Our government is too big, it's too bloated, it's too inefficient.
Don't you dare tell me this is a blue state, baby. Look at this. God bless you. Ladies and gentlemen, we are here for a very important purpose. We are here to elect our senator and our congresspeople to go down and change Washington. And we are blessed as a party to have so many wonderfully qualified, competent, electable candidates. And that's what we're here to do tonight. But myself and my partner, Senator McKinney, who you'll be hearing from next, are here to remind you of another fight. A fight that's taking place in every town and city across Connecticut the last 2 weeks. We are nominating our candidates for our state house, for our state senate. And with all due respect to those federal office seekers, I would submit to you, as I have in the past, that what goes on in that gold dome in Hartford affects your lives more than even what goes on in Washington every single day. So we're going to leave here pumped and excited about our federal candidates. But I ask you not to give up and think that your job is done, because it is our job to go back to our districts, back to our homes, and make sure that we take back Connecticut. Just 2 years ago, for the first time in almost a generation, the state of Connecticut elected a Democratic governor with overwhelmingly Democratic House and a Democratic Senate. One-party government for the first time in over a generation. Every state constitutional office was held by a Democrat. All of our federal offices by a Democrat. One-party rule. And where did it get us? We had a man who came in and said we were going to share sacrifice, that he was going to take us down a road less traveled. Well, let's examine where that road led us. Ladies and gentlemen, as we speak today, it is unfortunate for me to report to you that this state is in deficit. Yes, believe it or not, after the largest tax increase in the history of the state of Connecticut, $1.5 billion out of your pockets, this state is still in deficit. Ladies and gentlemen, we have taxed our citizenry to the point where we have $3.5 billion in extra revenue than we had less than 2 years ago, and we still can't pay our bills. We borrowed money just to pay the light bill. Gap, the generally accepted accounting principles that this governor and these Democrats said was the cornerstone of their policies, was thrown out the window. Every single campaign promise was broken. But I got to tell you something. 2 years ago, it was my privilege to address you and talk about our plan. Yes, we had 37 in the House and 12 in the Senate. And we said we were going to run and take our message to Connecticut. We were going to run on common sense. Five principles, as I said to you 2 years ago, that we learned at our kitchen table and our parents' knee. Spend no more than you make. Borrow no more than you can afford to pay back. If it ain't broke, don't fix it. But if it's not working, for God's sakes, get rid of it. The more government tries to do, the less it does well. And we should have all the government we need, but only the government we need. And we as candidates for the State House and State Senate signed that commitment. And we made a little history ourselves. We picked up 15 seats in the House, never before done since the end of the party lever, and kept every one of the seats we had. We broke their supermajority in the House, and the Senate picked up two more seats, breaking the supermajority in the Senate. Now, is it enough? No, not close. But because of the unity, the fight, the spirit, and the common sense commitment by those who are representing you in the Republican side under that gold dome, we have fought back so many things. Yes, we put forth not one, but seven consecutive no tax increase budgets, fully vetted, fully balanced. That's common sense. We did it without borrowing money, without bankrupting our towns. We did it with compassion, but most importantly, common sense. Ladies and gentlemen, when you go home, psyched from your experience here tonight, proud of those that we nominate, I ask you to work hard for your State House and State Senate candidates, because that is going to make all the difference. Before I turn it over to my colleague and my partner, I want to share with you a little story. Several years ago, when my three children were little, my wife and I read a little article in the Reader's Digest. It was about how a couple of young parents taught their kids about family unity and sticking together. We thought we'd try it ourselves. So we took a bunch of popsicle sticks, five as a matter of fact, representing each member of our family, and we glued them together, and we put them all in their Christmas stockings. When they woke up on Christmas morning, they pulled out the five glued together popsicle sticks and looked at us with curious eyes. We handed them a single popsicle stick, and we said, "Break it." It broke easily in their 5 and 7 and 9 year old hands. And then we handed them the five glued popsicle sticks and said, "Break it." They couldn't do it. Well, you know the lesson. When we stick together, nobody can break us. So, ladies and gentlemen, as we emerge from this convention as proud Connecticut Republicans, remember the story of the popsicle sticks. We're going to have our differences. We do have a big tent. We're going to have our disagreements. We might even have our primaries. But when it's all said and done, for the good of this state, to resurrect the majesty of Connecticut, to bring back common sense, and to restore our party to grandeur, let's stick together. God bless you, and thank you very much.